Hello everyone, welcome to this week's Wigner Colloquium. My name is Philipp Böckler, Institute of Theoretical Physics. It's a great pleasure to welcome Professor Dirk Helbing here to us to Berlin. We already had an intense discussion during the day, which I'm probably going to follow after talk. But before I hand over the stage to you, let me also give you a brief, some words of introduction. As many of you know Dirk Helbing from one way or the other, maybe I can share some additional information. So Dirk started out as a student studying physics and mathematics, which kind of sets the theme for all of his career. And in particular, in the beginning of his career, he looked at pedestrian traffic and crowd dynamic, crowd management. So he took statistical physics to logistics, you might want to call this, and to econophysics, which also a field that he helped to found and to shape and to establish. I put this little poster over here because he's also the founding father of the physics of social economics division, social economic systems division of the German Physical Society, which is going to have the next spring meeting here in Berlin. And we have also the local organizer sitting over there, Eckhard Schwell. He's been the spokesperson for that division for many years. And has been active in as counselor ever since. So in his career went on with a PhD in the University of Stuttgart, if I'm not mistaken. And then his first chair was at the TU in Dresden, where he soon also became managing director of the Institute for Traffic and Economics, or Econophysics, was called Economics, yes, Economics. That's where he was in, from 2000 to 2007, after which he moved on to his current home, which is the Eidgenössische Technische Hochschule in Zürich, so ETH Zürich, but he has been more or less a phenomenon because he is more like a density distribution across the globe. So he's been visited in the Weizmann Institute in Israel and other places there. He was in Harvard and other places in the US. He's holding an affiliate professorship at TU Delft. And his awards are also numerous. Let me just mention a few of them. He's been elected member of the Leopoldina, but also of the World Scientific Society for Art, or the World Society for Arts and Sciences, as it was called, quite recently, actually. So congratulations on that. And his key figures, if you look this up, so it's an age index of 92 or something, which is not impressive because it means he has published 92 papers. Well, so far so good, but also those papers have been cited at least 92 times leading up with this whole scientific output and all the papers and books that he has written. It's an aggregated citation of more than 40,000. So today he's going to speak to us about can physics help understand a fixed society? And this probably continues as part of this research efforts that he puts in into his future ICT, information, communication and technology, because he was also the coordinator of a very big attempt to win the EU flagship a couple of years ago. So which created also a lot of awareness in the public, in the society, public opinion. So quite recently, also this year, it has been restarted, I should say, Future ICT 2.0, as they call this. So maybe it's also the part of today's talk. But now, without further ado, let me hand over the microphone to you, dim the lights a little bit, and then take off.
Thank you very much for the introduction. I'm very pleased to be here. I've been Berlin many times now. I really love this city. I'm also happy to be here to speak to physicists. As you heard, I have physics backgrounds, but I won't talk about Lagrangians and Hamiltonians and Schrödinger equations today. Still, I want to talk about how physics thinking can be used to help us solve some of the problems that humanity is faced with. But of course, as a physicist, we're always thinking about grand challenges, right? So finding support for the theory, the standard theory of elementary particles, was of course something that physicists were very much subscribed to. And then after the finding of the Higgs particle, the question was, what would be another big challenge worthy going for? So what about understanding society? Now, as we know, the success of physics is based on its simplicity. We've seen that it was possible to describe the motion of planets with a superposition of circular movements, but there is a much simpler model, right, which is the ellipse, which is based on Newtonian equations. And so that makes all the difference. Today, we do have computer science that is coming up basically with digital doubles of everyone. These are black boxes that can learn and that are fed with data about you, data that's being collected every single day, quite a lot of data in fact. And in this way, this black box learns to behave similar to you. But you don't learn anything about why those digital doubles behave in this way, or why you behave in certain ways. That's the problem. So basically, that's a hypercycle theory of humans and society. What we're lacking is an analytical understanding that really informs us also to take measures to improve the system. And of course, when we talk about economy and social physics, then many people think about scaling laws. That will be the only slide about scaling laws that I'll be showing you. I started off with pedestrians. When I did my diploma thesis, I was wondering, what is there which is connecting physics with social sciences? And I was thinking about three subjects: group dynamics, arms race, and behavior of pedestrians. And I thought, well, that's worthy of a physicist, because there is some similarity. It's sufficiently complex, and there's a chance maybe to describe it in terms of mathematical formulas. So what I got fascinated about was self-organization within pedestrian crowds. As you can see over here, these lanes of uniform walking direction that are formed, so opposite directions of motion are segregated from each other, and that makes pedestrian flows so efficient. Now, this happens without the need of laws, traffic signs, policemen. Even most people don't know that they're doing this. It still happens. So it's true self-organization. So why is it happening? And in fact, as a physicist, we know there are similar systems. For example, if you share a system of small and large particles, then you will see size segregation of particles. So the idea is that we could actually understand the lane formation phenomenon, the self-organization pedestrian, based on force models. That means as if pedestrians were something like driven or self-driven particles. And we could apply methods from physics, such as molecular dynamics or force models, in order to describe and understand the phenomenon. And so, at some point in time, I came up with the social force model of pedestrian motion. And it assumes that people would learn to behave more or less optimally, probably during their childhood and their experiment, and eventually they learn how to improve their behavior in response to other pedestrians, and that creates a typical response pattern, a typical dynamics that we might be able to describe through equations of motion and acceleration equations, which I have done over here. And the equation of motion is nothing that would surprise anyone, but the question is how to specify an acceleration. And I decided that I was first trying to describe it as a superposition of various forces that would describe different motivations of a pedestrian. For example, to move with a certain desired speed into a desired direction of motion. So the actual velocity would be adapted to this and would take time. Then, of course, I assumed there would be interactions between a pedestrian alpha with all the other pedestrians beta around them. There would be interactions with boundaries, and in many cases, we've also added a flux calculation term in order to account for that we wouldn't sufficiently well describe by those other terms. In particular, variations of behavior. Now, of course, we've done simulations. I'll show you some later on. But then the physicists would ask, is this just theory, or could we actually make measurements? Could we make experiments? So when we talk about interaction forces or interaction potentials, physicists would make scattering experiments, right? And of course, at the time when I did that research, I was aware of this, but I thought it would never be possible to do such a thing. But eventually, the radio technology became so good that it was possible actually to perform experiments and do the measurements. Right? So people were equipped here with those table tennis balls on their shoulders, and we made it more easy to track them and their motion. And we were studying typical situations like one pedestrian walking around another one, or two pedestrians meeting each other and having to walk around each other, and three pedestrians, and all these kind of things, right? So we did it as a physicist would have done it. And we actually determined the force field empirically, right? So that really became possible. It became possible to reproduce basically the average trajectories, also the asymmetry in the avoidance behavior, because in Europe, pedestrians have a tendency to walk towards the right side, and that tendency is even much stronger when both pedestrians walk. That means there's a reinforcement effect. So after we came up with database specification of those force models, or even data-driven, then we decided we would test it also in an entirely new situation, namely in the interaction of many pedestrians in a pedestrian zone. So completely independent validation, and in fact it turns out that the distribution of pedestrians over the walkway was very well reproduced. And here are these fascinating self-organization patterns that we can find in computer simulation. So, as you can see over here, lane formation is clearly visible. It hasn't been there at the beginning, but by now there's a clear separation between directions of motion. What matters here then is the relative velocity of people meeting each other, and of course when that happens, they would have to walk a little bit to the right or to the left, and that separates the different directions of motion, and in the end you stay with a pattern that is the most stable in time, right? Which is basically a pattern with two lanes. But also at bottlenecks you would find interesting collective patterns of motion, namely oscillations. And we found that quite interesting. We can understand that by the buildup of pressure in the waiting crowd, and so eventually they would occupy the door and then turn the flow. And this goes on and on and on and on. So looks like it would be a traffic light, but there isn't. This is all self-organized. The question then is, what happens if two streams of pedestrians would cross each other? Like, if you're the only one having to cross a stream of pedestrians, and this flow of pedestrians is like a wall, it's very difficult to get through. But if there are two streams of pedestrians, what will happen? Do you have any idea? People don't like detours. What really happens is quite fascinating, because it turns out it's possible to walk through the other flow without even stopping. And it happens like this, through a phenomenon called stripe formation, where people would move forward with the stripes, they would walk sideways within the strides, and this way you can penetrate the flow without stopping. This is really amazing. And then nobody of us would have figured that out within a few minutes. But if we get into this kind of situation, we just do it without even thinking about it. So this is self-compensation. Fascinating. And all these insights can be used basically to improve pedestrian facilities. Pedestrian facilities are made up of elements such as corridors, bottlenecks, and intersections. All of this can be improved, it turns out. And well understood for this situation over here, if you cut away those corners, then obviously we would avoid those obstructions. This chaos that occurs when people from the side are trying to get into the main flow. So creating a funnel would improve the flow, even though we're taking away some space. After we've understood that you know, less is more, taking away space can improve the situation, you would start thinking about a corridor. And it turns out that actually putting pillars into the way would stabilize the interface between the two opposite flows, and at the same time it's flexible. And as you've seen it in that movie over here from the subway station in Budapest, everyone is now coming towards us, but then a train arrives and people are also walking the opposite direction. After a very short time, two flow directions are separating from each other. And actually what is possible is to improve architectural designs with evolutionary algorithms. It's also possible to improve intersections by putting obstacles in the way over there in order to create a rotary flow. They can also simulate large-scale situations. In this case, we're simulating the center of Dresden, and service hours, pedestrians are now entering the streets Sunday morning, and that's not a problem at all. We've also simulated a million people. That needs a little bit more computer power, but anyway, in the meantime, these kinds of models are being used also to simulate really detailed, real scenarios with multimodal traffic, means subways and trams and buses and pedestrians and cars and maybe even logistics and large scale sports events and other things. So this kind of social physics has really made it into real life applications. Of course, every physicist would think, oh, that seems to have something in common with gas kinetics or with fluid dynamics. And in fact, this is the case. Or also with granular materials, as I said before. So, I was also asked to look into video recordings of crowd disasters that had happened about 10 years ago. And I was in Mina, close to Mecca, in Saudi Arabia, where pilgrims do the Hajj every year, basically. And this is the Jamra Bridge, the old one, which has three pillars located on it, representing the devil, particularly the temptation by the devil. And of course, as a believer, you're supposed to resist the temptation by the devil. In order to demonstrate that, you're supposed to throw some pebbles against those pillars to show the devil you're not being tempted. You know, you resist the temptation. Now, if 3 million people do this in a day, things get very crowded, and there have been a lot of crowd disasters in the past. Many people have died. And also in this year, a crowd disaster happened, and it happened in open space, just in the entrance area. this entrance area, I think, is 40 meter wide, the bridge is 80 meter wide, so this is really a lot of space in the sink. So how could the ground disaster happen? Well, we got to see the video recordings, we did analysis, it turned out that flows from different directions were merging in front of the bridge entrance, and that effectively created a bottleneck situation. And what happened then basically was that after some time, surprisingly, stop and go waves set in, as you can see over here. And we can also identify the conditions under which this happens, basically when the fundamental diagram, the flow density curve, turns, like over here, this thing happens. But that was not the only thing that happened. Besides a laminar flow under normal flow conditions at reasonably small and moderate densities, and the stop and go, stop and go, stop and go flow, we found a third state, which we call crowd turbulence, because people were pushed around really in very chaotic ways into all sorts of directions. And this is actually what caused the crowd disaster. So the stop and go waves were a warning half an hour before the crowd disaster started, but this is the crowd turbulence. So people are really pushed around, the waves extend over many meters, more than 10 meters sometimes. And it's basically pushing people to fall to the ground, and then a hole is created within the crowd, which means that suddenly, you know, people are pushing from the sides and from the back, but there's nobody anymore pushing from the front. So they will be pushing you on top of that person. And so many people fall on top of each other, and that creates a very dangerous situation where many people would suffocate. So it's physics which basically makes people die. And the situation is very similar as in a granular material where force chains are formed. And the forces that act upon you would change the direction and intensity or size suddenly. You couldn't easily anticipate that. That's why there's such a high risk of falling. So that is the challenge, basically, to stay on your feet when you're pushed around by this dense crowd. And a little bit of shaking of your body would create forces that are acting on other bodies, and they would add up to really large forces that pushed around. So that had to change, obviously. And in fact, the entire area was reorganized. But there's now, strangely enough, there's now apparently a slide missing. So as you can see, that was the situation before. The emergency vehicles had really huge difficulties to reach the people who were in need of help. After the reorganization towards unidirectional flows, flow organization, and a number of other measures taken, things were much more orderly, and pilgrims also liked this new organization a lot. For many years, crowd disasters didn't happen. Everyone was happy with the result. And then in 2015, suddenly there was another crowd disaster at a time where I was not involved for many years. So when I changed to ETH Zurich, I quit this activity, and I was not at all involved, and a lot of things have been changed. In particular, in that plan, there were crossing flows of pilgrims. And this is actually what caused the accident. That means the going away from the unidirectional flow organization, and that is what caused the accident. So that's actually the paper of the other group that had organized things in that year, and that apparently didn't work so well. So here is another example of crowd turbulence. You can see it actually happen in Duisburg during the Love Parade, and as you remember, there was also this crowd design that people didn't understand at the beginning. And I said, I suppose that it was crowd turbulence that caused the accident, and in fact, the movies support that conclusion. So we understand much better what causes disaster and also how disasters can be avoided. And then eventually I also turned my attention to other subjects, for example, traffic flow, and did my habilitation in this area. Now, later on, and now many years after I started coming up with theoretical models, we got to see data of real traffic flows, and those data looked like this. You can see it's amazingly complex. To be honest, if I had seen those patterns in the beginning, I would probably have chosen another subject. But at that time, it was a matter of honor to explain it, right? With the models all the time. So the idea was basically similar to what physicists have done in other areas. So they're trying to understand matter from elementary particles. So I would say, couldn't we try to understand those complex patterns as a result of the combination of many elementary patterns? And those are the elementary patterns that we identified. Moving localized clusters, pinned localized clusters, stuck and go waves, oscillating congested traffic, homogeneous congested traffic. And in fact, those elementary patterns can be simulated with surprisingly simple traffic models, assuming a bottleneck, for example, an on-ramp where cars would enter the freeway, and different flow conditions. So as you can see, there are amazingly many different congestion patterns in traffic flows. And it can all be understood with pretty simple models such as this intelligent driver model and also fluid and dynamic traffic models, which have an acceleration equation and an equation of motion, and then some assumptions about the preferred distance that cars would like to have, or driver vehicle units. And based on these kind of models, we can determine a certain kind of self-organized constants of traffic flow, such as the outflow from congested traffic, or the backward propagation speed of the front of traffic jam. These are constants that can be understood with traffic theory. You can compare them with kind of the constants from physics, like gravitational constant or elementary charge, these kind of things. So we have, in a sense, equivalence in the theory of traffic flow. Now, with these kind of constants and in some other constants that determine the flows at which traffic becomes unstable or metastable, we can determine theoretical phase diagrams that would predict what kind of traffic states you would expect to find under what kind of flow condition. So this is the upstream flow of the freeway. This is the bottleneck strength, say the flow of vehicles entering the freeway. The sum of those flows is the overall traffic volume downstream of the on-ramp. So as we increase traffic volume, of course, we go from free traffic to congested traffic. There is a threshold. And we can understand all those different lines in those graphs over here. Theoretically, we understand where stop-and-go waves or oscillating congested traffic occurs, where homogeneous congested traffic occurs, and where also those localized congestion variants occur, it will be your opinion. And as you can see, things depend on the question whether perturbations in the traffic flow are small or large. That means there's multi-stability, history dependence, right? Nucleation effects, all these kind of things. So you notice that there's a lot of physics in this. And now the phase diagram of real traffic is, of course, an overlay of those two, as in many cases you don't know how large exactly the perturbation was. But then if you make the effort to look into data of real traffic flows and put them into a similar flow chart, then you would see the separation of those different traffic patterns, like moving localized clusters, pink localized clusters, stop-and-go wave, oscillatory congested traffic, and homogeneous congested traffic on the right. So, as expected effect, right, there is a very nice correspondence between what was theoretically predicted and what was empirically found later on. So these are predictive models, right? They're also predictive in the sense that we can actually determine theoretically the extension of congestion patterns in space and time. And the only thing that we cannot say is when is the moment when traffic breaks down? Because this is often triggered by a single incident, like an overtaking maneuver would occur. So we can say that even though traffic flows involve humans, and even though it's a pretty complex set of phenomena based on highly nonlinear dynamics, there is an analytical theory of traffic flow. So we have been, I think, very successful in understanding what was going on. And this graph basically shows that perturbations in the flow are very important. They're triggering a lot of those breakdowns of traffic flow, and that has implications actually for the way to avoid traffic congestion. And in fact, at that time I was involved in a project long before people were talking about Google self-driving cars, where we had been talking about cars with perception features, using sensors and measurements, communication features, cognition, I mean, determination of traffic state, cooperatively, decision making, and all these kind of things. And this has not only been done theoretically and in computer simulation, but it has been tested in real cars, and been sitting in such cars, driving in real traffic flows on freeways and in cities, you know, 10 years ago. And it was amazing. So this is a simulation. At the moment I'm just showing the situation that we have today and this annoying stop and go traffic that we'd like to get rid of. This is just to show you that we understand the process that we can reproduce. And that was actually the accelerometer. So, we're now annoyed enough of this traffic jam, so we will change the vehicle, we'll enter a helicopter to see what's going on. And as you can see, vehicles are entering the freeway, which produces small perturbations. Those perturbations are then amplified, and that causes a stop and go traffic. By the way, the 3D representation was all programmed by Martin Driver. And then what we do is we turn on a traffic assistance system where cars are now switching on a radar sensor that measures the distance and relative velocity, and we let the cars drive automatically in a slightly changed way. That means we change the interaction mechanism. We don't control those cars centrally. We just let them respond to each other in slightly different ways. Mechanism design. And as you could see, actually, the traffic jam dissolved. And we did that by stabilizing the traffic flow and slightly increasing the capacity of the traffic flow. And that was basically done by introducing real-time measurements that enabled us to introduce real-time feedbacks in the system. That was all. And then the question was, could we do that also for other systems, like urban traffic flow, right? Or in some cities you have this kind of situation. Instead, you would like to have a situation like this, in other words, basically things work in the self organized way. And the amazing thing is that even though this is a highly heterogeneous system, and even though there are no traffic lights and no high technology, you know, the people almost never have to stop. And the reason is a particular design of this intersection. This design has a unidirectional flow in the front. It has a unidirectional flow in the back. So in opposite directions are separated from each other through a buffer which allows every participant to adjust the speed in such a way that there will be a gap in the flow when you arrive to cross it. That's all. Genius design. And so the question is, could we also come up with self-organized traffic flows in urban areas? And in fact, we were inspired by the oscillatory flows and bottlenecks. We said, you know, are an intersection bottlenecks as well, just for more different flow directions. Couldn't we then apply a pressure principle to define oscillations? That means, couldn't we let the traffic flow control the traffic lights rather than the other way around? And so I said, you know, let's forget about everything that's been done about traffic light control in the past. How would the complex system scientists, thinking in terms of self-organizing system, go about it? And so we were comparing three different approaches. This is the common approach today. It's a central traffic control authority. Basically, it tries to collect as much data as possible and then come up with an optimal traffic light schedule, and that would be imposed on the city. And every traffic light would do what the traffic center says, and every driver would do what the traffic lights say. You know, that's a dependable on the dictator approach. Unfortunately, you can vary so many parameters of those intersections that you cannot solve the optimization problem in real time. And at the same time, the variability of the traffic flows is so big as the average. That means, while they come up with optimal traffic control schemes for typical traffic situations, like Monday morning between 9 and 10, or Friday afternoon between 3 and 4, or before the soccer game, or after the concert, whatever, and would apply the optimal solution to the typical situation, this typical situation would never really occur. You have an optimal solution for a situation that doesn't occur. You adjust it a little bit today, you know, with sensors and all this, but still you have repetitive cyclical periodic operation, and then you try to synchronize cycles. So you throw away a lot of solutions, in particular the non-variable ones. The second approach is very different. So here the intersections which try to optimize the travel time of those cars approaching, strictly, like homo economicus, and absolutely selfish. You know, you want to do your best job, and every intersection would do that. we would say, but centralized optimization should work better, right? Then the third thing is, as the second, but if there is a long traffic jam, we would first clear the traffic jam in order to avoid spillover effects. That means the other regarding control before we go back to optimization. We would think, well, that's nice and friendly, but it would not be performing as well as this. So that should be the best, that's the second best, and that's the third best. Let's look what really happens. This is what really happens. So, top-down regulation. As the capacity utilization of the intersection increases, queue length increases to almost linearly. Yeah. Sounds reasonable. For the selfish optimization, local optimization, we find this. Oh, much better. Because it's flexible. It would respond to single arriving cars, right? Offer them green lights before they even arrive. But then suddenly this graph explodes, queue length really becomes enormous. So the traffic control center said, see, that's why you pay the millions for us. And of course, we have to fix the problem over here. But now what happens? Wait a moment. So basically, what we can say is Adam Smith's invisible hand, self optimization in other words, works from here to there, yeah? But it fails over there. What happens then with the third approach that looks also with towards the neighbors? What happens then with the next upstream intersection? Well, that actually works much better than the centralized control approach all the way, because it flexibly responds to the actual traffic situation, may come up with non-periodic solutions. And so we can make the invisible hand work. Self-organization, bottom-up organization, and outsmart, centralized, top-down control. And in fact, it works, right? So we talked to the city of Dresden, and they said, oh, we have a messy area in the center, and it looks like this. And we have green waves over there, which are even adaptive, but we cannot prioritize public transport because that would really mess up the green waves, and then we would have monster congestion in the city in just a few minutes. So these are all the trams and buses, so it's really messy, right? So, given the same data, for the simulation. This is how things compare. That's today's approach. State of the art control, you see the green waves, the cars are being jammed up and then they're released and they pass several sections, right? You can see our flexible self-control is much more flexible. It basically uses those gaps that happen to open up in the traffic flow. And it turns out that actually everyone is benefiting from it. Public transport a lot, of course now you can do some prioritization. Even individualized car traffic is still improving and pedestrian sizes are benefiting as well. And the environment too. So then is the question, can we also come up with self-organization schemes to improve the state of society? I have to speed up a little bit, so this is all about cooperation, I mean, overcoming pollution, overfishing, global warming, tragedies of the comets. And there are problems which are kind of similar to traffic flow problems, because the desirable state, in case of traffic, free traffic flow, in this case cooperation, would be unstable. So it would collapse, and as a result, something undesirable would happen, traffic jams or tragedies of the commons. And the question is, how could we change the interactions, keyword mechanism design, in such a way that cooperation would occur? And it turns out that there are a lot of decentralized mechanisms that can do the job. First of all, when people sanction non-cooperative behavior, this helps. But only if there is spatial or network interaction. So if everyone would interact with everyone else or with randomly selected people, that wouldn't work well. It turns also out that actually success-driven migration is able to create cooperation. Simulating this, we're starting with everyone non-cooperative. Blue is cooperation. There's some mutation in the system, there's some random migration, some successful migration, an imitation of the best performing neighboring behavior. And then after 25,000 iterations, you find a small cooperative cluster here, just by coincidence. And once it's there, there is a nucleation effect that would spread cooperation all over. Well, I know migration is not a very popular topic these days, but the point is, you know, to establish this cooperation, you would have to establish cooperative clusters all over the world, right? And that is the trick that works. So maybe we'd have to send some Germans to other countries. Anyway, I don't want to get political here. We can test things also in the lab. Surprisingly, this is all working. There are other mechanisms, such as if you let more cooperative people interact with more cooperative people, this not only helps to reward your own cooperation, but it would also increase the average level of cooperation. And also, punishment isn't actually needed. There are more effective mechanisms, such as altruistic signaling. So information can be surprisingly powerful. And then there is one thing that really allows us to be a little bit optimistic about the future, which is people are social beings. And that's quite surprising for some economists in tech. Well, they would share even money with others, as the Ultimatum and the Big Data Games show. And the question is, how can we understand it? And so we have simulated a system in which people strictly maximize their so-called utility function. The utility function would consider the own payoff, success in other words, and the payoff of interaction partners with weighted with some friendliness parameter, but that friendliness parameter would be set to zero in the very beginning. That means in the beginning, everyone is unfriendly. Everyone is selfish. But friendliness is a trait that is inherited to offspring, and this inheritance would include some mutation. And as a result, we find this result. So Homo economicus, the selfish individual results all over the place, apart from here, where people have social preferences after quite a few generations, in fact. I mean, it takes many generations until cooperation pays off. And this happens when people raise their children in their neighborhood. In fact, humans are the only species that do that for about 20 years. So that is what made us social, that made us friendly and fair to some extent. So not everyone is fair, we know this, now there are some selfish people, but most of us have some pro-social preferences, and now we understand this. You know, so we're networked minds in a sense. I'll skip a few slides here. This is about social norms, conflicts. We can understand this, we can improve it also with agent-based models, and we can use data science, of course, as we have it today, to come up with all sorts of new solutions, to look into new compasses for decision makers, to understand spreading of culture and migration, spreading of conflict, to simulate problems such as resilience of gas supply or epidemic spreading or come up with platforms that would actually allow us to participate in systems. And we've been also working on such platforms such as NervousNet, that is actually using smartphones to measure the environment around us. So you can turn your smartphone into a measurement device. We could connect our smartphones to measure the world in principle and create all sort of data and come up with possibilities to sense objects like a radar system. We even gamified it, there's treasure hunt. We can measure the environment together, the resources that uses them, swamp piles is such an app. We have created an app that measures the spread of a flu, of gripe, in a participatory way that gives people some information, also platforms that help people to consume more consciously. And I think with this, I'd like to come to an end to give you more time for discussion. We've also, of course, looked into opinion formation and other problems and how to improve democracy, but I'd like to end on an optimistic note, which is the point now in this super networked world is basically that we need to learn to bring the knowledge and ideas of brilliant minds together. So we need to create collective intelligence, solutions and intelligence better than individual intelligence, based on the world, a world that is grown together through this networking effect. And as this movie shows, in fact, this will happen. Just a matter of time. So stay tuned and God bless you. Thank you.
Questions, comments.
You're missing a Hamilton function.
Maybe you notice in the section here in front, the soil atlas. It's a roundabout, but it has traffic lines. And I find this very unintuitive that they put traffic lines, because I saw that it would be much better for traffic flow, and in fact it happens very often that traffic breaks down here and nothing moves at all. From your intuition, would you also think that for roundabouts like that, would be better for traffic lines?
So roundabouts are actually an excellent way of supporting self-organization and traffic flows, and it works amazingly well under many conditions. But there is a capacity limit, and once you reach that capacity limit, you need traffic lights. I can't tell whether this overcapacity situation is actually happening at the asphalt plants, right? I mean, that should be figured out. But in principle, I guess that it would be useful to switch off the traffic lights at certain times of the day, at least. But they're not doing this, and apparently they're not using the benefit of a traffic circle.
Yeah, okay.
In the first part, you said sort of that you could gain these social forces for pedestrians just from the experiments and observations. So if I think about this last part about cooperation and such things, is there also a way to extract so the rules which people follow, or you are mainly based on the assumptions that they place a business dilemma or something?
Well, we've been looking at these kind of things. So basically we started off with models that were based on assumptions. Of course we couldn't have data in the beginning, and then later on we calibrated parameters in assumed models, and then we came up with data-driven models, right? and then eventually even with cognitive models. Now, in principle, what you can do is also come up with cognitive agents today. There's enough computer power, and so that then just learn from scratch, basically, to behave in good ways. But that is actually what now Google does with the AI that's being used to play Go. Right? The first generation, AlphaGo, was still programmed and it learned from games that masters had played before and all this. The new generation is learning from scratch and just plays games against itself. Millions of games until it's better than any player in the world. And so, in principle, when we learn to move as a pedestrian, we do something similar, right? I mean, I don't think our parents really tell us exactly how to move and how to put this foot in front of the other foot and all this. And now we just learn it step by step.
I'm asking how physicists know what people are doing, not how people themselves, not how computer learns to play Go. But what are, so, say, how you extract rule of interaction from the behavior of the people?
What we do is we use trajectories extracted from movies and sometimes from real situations, and basically we compare simulations of single pedestrians given their environment.
How you do here in minds and interactions of social behavior and altruism and such things, how you base on data in this?
Okay, so what we do is basically we specify payoff matrices. So these payoff matrices specify the game, the kind of interaction situation that people are involved in. And what happens if one kind of behavior meets another kind of behavior? How much success you would have? That's measured in terms of payoff. And then basically what you have to specify also is an interaction rule. So would people interact with everyone, or would they just interact with their neighbors, which is what we assume over here. Then there's usually the assumption of either imitation of the best performing neighbor's behavior, or something like an optimization, in the sense that you check out which of the possible behaviors that you have at your disposal would maximize your payoff if your neighbors wouldn't change their behavior. That's the kind of rules that people are looking at. Really different kinds of settings that are being simulated and tested. Another popular rule is, for example, win, stay, lose, shift. That means it assumes that people would repeat their previous successful behavior if they're satisfied with the outcome, and otherwise they would change their behavior, either change them, or they would move to another place. So these are the kind of rules, so more or less plausible rules, and many of them are now being tested also in laboratories. I showed you our laboratories in one of the slides to figure out where the real people really behave as assumed in those experiments, and eventually to improve those models. Exactly in the same way as you do in physics, so you know, you come up with an experiment or observation, then you come up with a theory, then you make predictions, compare the predictions with the outcomes of the experiments, improve your model, and so on, until you have a model that is satisfactory in describing a certain kind of situation. Now, what you'd like to have is a model, however, that can also describe other kinds of situations that the model hasn't been made for. And in fact, the nice thing about the pedestrian traffic models that I showed you before is that the very same model can describe many different phenomena. So So they're quite powerful models from that point of view that allow us to understand why certain things happen and what kind of conditions. And this very same thing is now going on with these evolutionary game theoretical models, where we want to understand kind of universality classes of situations where cooperation occurs or fails, where conflict occurs or is dissolved, where norms, social norms, are forming or not. These kind of situations, because they determine whether two people would go in war or not. And of course, we'd like to avoid such war from happening, so we need to know what are the situations that would potentially trigger war, and what can we do in order to change the situation into a peaceful one.
Regarding the data for behavioral data, you can do experiments, but I think a big advantage of technology nowadays is that such data regarding our desires and what our goals are, what we want to do and who we are friends with, is passively collected, but of course not available probably because big corporations own these data. And I think if you say we have to go towards self-organization, at the moment it feels kind of different, because when I type into Google Maps where I want to go, it tells me the optimized route because some algorithm optimizes this. So is your idea basically that Google, not Google, but my phone app would tell me, I'm standing on a traffic lane, and it would tell me all the directions these people want to go, and we can kind of communicate with each other and adjust our goals basically in order to find a solution for us all, because that's for me a cooperation scenario. So in the end, such a scenario would require open data, right? So that we know all the goals and ideas from the others, and at the moment they are basically put into this black box and we get our job, what we should do by the phone, and then it's not very, at the moment it doesn't feel very simple.
Right.
So maybe I can also add something, because you mentioned two concepts. One is the so the smartphone being used as sensors. That's also what you said, and then you also had this idea of feedback. So at the moment, some is more sensor data, but can you also use this to provide feedback to everyone, so to optimize not only your own route, but also for the common good, also the route of the others.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So we do experiments not only in the lab, but also we do online experiments using Amazon Mechanical Turk. So we created an own platform for such kind of experiments. Moreover, this nervous net can be used to crowdsourcing of data. So the idea is that we all together would create platforms with open source software that could be adapted to your own needs and applications, and would collectively be grown to have more and more functionality in terms of creating data, evaluating data, using it for all sorts of things, but also providing feedback, in fact. Yeah? So when it comes to route choice, and there is OpenStreetMap, for example. This is actually built into this OnePulse app. Yeah, so we're using these kind of things. But if you get excited about this entire idea to kind of let the society self-organize in a bottom-up way to support coordination and cooperation through feedbacks in a system that we build and operate ourselves as the people, as the civil society, then yeah, please join in. We'd like to create hubs for these kind of activities in many cities of the world. So currently this is happening in Zurich and in Delft and in London and some other places, and Berlin of course should also be on the map, right? So this is open source. This is a crowdsourced project, so this is a project for everyone.
I think the drawing from the
it seems more interesting, in fact, yeah.
And that's so, really awesome. I mean, it doesn't, maybe it's concept that you have from physics, maybe it simply doesn't apply. I mean, all these concepts were developed for physics. Why should the same basic mechanisms work in a society?
Well, I didn't say this. I mean, I'm not seeing myself as a social physicist in the sense that, you know, I'm using equations from physics and now I'm kind of renaming variables and interpreting outcomes in different ways. This looks similar like magnetism, you know, that's called that the spin system, and kind of open information thing or whatever. Social scientists don't appreciate that. And I've been always somebody who's been looking at a problem that I want to understand, and that I was trying to find a suitable method to describe the phenomenon, and those methods have been very different, you know, from force models to Fokker-Planck models and Boltzmann models and simulation models in networks and all these kinds of things, depending on what needed to be understood. In fact, I'd like to stress the limitations of a physics approach, because exactly as you say, when individuals interact, emergence happens, like groups are formed, and those groups may have a group spirit, a shared value system, and that feeds back on the individual. That means the individual start changing behavior, because we have a doubly complex system. It's not just kind of a multi-particle system. Those particles, in a sense, if you want to compare them with particles at all, they have a brain, and this brain in itself has a complex dynamics. It learns, it adapts, it changes, the behavior and property of the particles. In fact, of course, not particles, we're humans. But the interesting point, of course, is that in a complex system, in many cases, among the millions or billions of variables that are in the game, most of them don't matter. And this is where physics can really help to understand why is this the case? Why is it that there are just a few variables that finally determine certain kind of phenomena? What are those variables? Under what situations and so on? So, we know, for example, that far away from phase transition point, details often don't matter so much. You know, there is an averaging out effect. And then, however, at the phase transition point, suddenly the smallest details might matter, making a big difference. You know? These are things that I believe are also, to some extent, transferable to phenomena that we see in society. And that in itself is already helpful. Then also, of course, the different universality classes of possible outcomes is something that is this interesting to distinguish and understand what are kind of the basic ingredients for conflict, for example, right? That's quite interesting. I think we can learn something, but we also always need to be aware of the limitations. And as somebody working in this field that today is not anymore so much called social physics, but computational social science, and we have a confluence of data science and computer science and social physics and other related fields, mathematical sociology and so on, it's important to read sociology books and sociology literature to come up with something meaningful, come up with answers to questions that haven't been answered by social scientists before or not satisfactorily answered. And that will make you a successful scientist in this field.
So I think with your career, you already showed that physicists can have an impact in a lot of different fields, but it's also worthwhile going beyond the borders of your own discipline. So working in traffic, economy, and now you're even with the Department of Computer Science. Computational social science as the department. So I think we stop at this point. So thank you very much for having your talk here, which I hope accelerate knowledge, as you put it in the title of your future ICT program, and also some examples of crises could be received. So if you want to continue this discussion, please be welcome to join us for dinner. We'll be passing by the atrium downstairs on the ground floor around 6 o'clock, and then go to a restaurant nearby. So if you want to hang around for about like half an hour, then we'll pick you up down there. And if not, thank you very much for coming, and thanks for the questions. Hope to see you next time. Thanks. Wiener Kolloquium or some other events. Thank you very much, and please join me giving a hand to the campaigners. Thank you very much.